Hey folks, how's it going? I'm Josh, and we're checking out Tipsy. Chris O'Dowd has everyone in stitches with the Banksy story, The Last Leg. Guys, please continue to leave comments below. All our videos are based off your comments and suggestions, and if you are subscribed, we check out those first. We also have a Patreon, guys, but if you cannot afford to donate to the Patreon, that's cool. Just continue to like, share, subscribe, and comment below, and it helps the videos a lot. And this is a recommendation from one of the patrons, so let's jump into it.
Jessica, is it true your family's from Ukraine?
Yeah, my grandfather.
Right.
Yeah.
Is there a chance you're a Russian spy?
Definitely, I'm a Russian spy. Yes. Yeah. No, I'm not a Russian spy. I am, and I'm not. And maybe I am. You'll never know.
Well, now I don't know. I just can't gauge.
Do you think Russian trolls are going to jump on board the new series of Get Shorty? That's your new series that you're in. Would you? Is there anything in that they could?
I mean, we'd welcome their input. I feel like they have a lot of influence on how people are watching stuff.
Yeah.
I have a theory about trolls.
Yes.
Which I'd like to share on this platform.
Please do.
Which is that this is... You know what I'm talking about. Yeah. But this is the first wave of the apocalypse is this Russian troll horseshit.
Yeah.
But right after that, they become legitimized and become just like normal public relations people working in Soho. And the only way that we can tell that they're slightly different is they've got the hats and whatnot. I presume all the Russian trolls have the hats.
Yeah, they do.
And and they will become what we all watch. So when like the people from Strictly Have a Kiss or whatever, it'll be Russian trolls that are just like, they'll just be normal PR people in London. Because they've worked out how to do it. And we'll trust them because they've been so horribly accurate and successful.
Chris, my next question was going to be, it was your birthday this week, how did you celebrate? But I'm going to change that.
I want to make sure I'm not lost. I'm assuming he's talking about like how Russian controls have all this influence and convince you to watch stuff and do things that you otherwise wouldn't do without their influence. And PR people essentially do the same thing. And that's their job, is to convince you to get into something, like when it comes to public relations, or convince you to like or do certain things because they put something in a specific, like a negative light or a positive light. So essentially Russian trolls and PR people are the same thing. That's what I'm getting. I want to make sure I'm not missing up another part of the story.
Chris, it was your birthday this week. Did you stop celebrating?
I feel like nearer to the end becomes more of a celebration because of all of the reasons you've outlined. We went this week. It was my birthday. I don't want everybody to make a big deal out of it. It was my birthday. It was a big one. It was 39, which, you know, is a real milestone. And we went to my wife, I'm married, I don't want to make a big deal out of that. My wife brought me to a restaurant that's in the dark.
Yes, I heard about this.
And it's all bound. Have you heard about this?
I've never heard of that. No, I've never heard of that place.
So the entire place is in the dark,
mm-hmm.
And the waiters are all blind.
Right.
And
and you thought you'd join in?
I'm sorry.
What happened?
Hey, it's a fair assumption, Adam. The circumstances before you don't need to be shy about that.
Here's my question. What happened when the cake came out? It's a restaurant in the dark. It's an all-dark dining experience.
Yeah.
Someone light the candles and they went, well, you've ruined it for everyone. By the way, while we're talking about cakes, Elle asked, and I do want to cover this week, is it okay to refuse to bake a cake which mentions gay rights? Now, back in 2014, the Christian owners of a bakery in Northern Ireland refused to bake a cake supporting same-sex marriage. This is the colourful cake that was eventually made by another bakery.
Oh, it's good.
This week, though, the Supreme Court ruled that the bakers were within their right to refuse the cake because you can't force someone to endorse an opinion they don't believe in. What do we think?
Well, how do you know they just didn't like Sesame Street?
That's entirely possible. It's entirely possible they didn't like Sesame Street.
Well, that's wrong. It's wrong.
Yeah.
It's wrong not to like Sesame Street.
Yeah, that's yeah.
So wrong.
See, here's the thing. I think it's kind of a fair ruling because it also means you can't force a gay baker to make a cake that says, for instance, homosexuality is a sin. So a lot of people were going back and forth on it this week. I kind of figure...
I'm just wondering what the celebration is. They're like, Oh, I'd like homosexuality as a sin. On
the Westboro no back the church.
Don't worry, he's going to eat it in the dark. He'll never know.
I understand that it's a hypothetical, yeah, yeah. But like, why the cake?
Is it okay that Banksy just perpetrated the best comment on the superficiality of the art world? Jesus. And is it okay that the painting is worth more now that it's shredded? Now, a work of art by Banksy was sold for over £1 million at auction this week and was immediately destroyed by a shredder that was built into the frame. It is speculated the prank possibly caused the artwork to double in value.
Wow. I think it's amazing.
Do you think, is it?
I think it's brilliant. I'm not really a fan of Banksy, but I thought it was amazing. I also would like to know what the next item at the auction went for. I wish he'd got the frames the wrong way round, and when he started doing it, the Mona Lisa had gone down by
What's even, what I love about this is one collector then sliced up their own £40,000 Banksy print with a Stanley knife, hoping it would also double in value. It's now worth a pound.
I'll give him a tenner.
Chris,
I used to live in.
Yep.
Sweet. I used to live in Bermondsey for a long time.
Yep.
And in Bermondsey, they had an actual like fucking Banksy thing on the wall. Because it was a real fucking place rather than a Sotheby's. Whatever. And so there was this like art walk that we would walk by all the time when I was walking my dog.
I love that guy's laugh. He was killing me on the Johnny Vegas one. That dude has a great laugh.
And the dog. He had done this piece on a wall.
Yeah.
Which was like, people actually may be familiar with, just like a barking dog.
Yeah.
Piece. That, for whatever reason, my dog thought was the place that he should take a piss. And so he would go there and take a piss that was behind Perspex.
Yeah.
Because that's what they do with the banks. It's all over London now, they do that.
And so. Are you watching, Kanye? Are you watching? Okay, we have to talk more about extravagant purchases. We've gone to a bit of effort to cover this.
I hadn't even, like...
I don't get the Kanye bit. I have to look that up, see what he did. Was Kanye, like, drunk on the show or something before or something? I had to look that up.
I understand that there is kind of time constraints.
Chris, can I...
You got in the know! Hold on.
We got a story to tell, man.
We're not on, like, this is fucking chump.
You're not or,
let's not be silly about it. Like, I'm just saying, what my dog was attracted to...
Right, the basic.
Was the image of a dog.
Yeah.
And so he would piss against a Banksy print
yeah.
every day. And to me, I thought that was art.
The hell are you talking about? Ah, that dude was tipsy. That was good. I enjoyed that. It was cool to kind of see him in this, because I got the... Like I just started watching IT Crowd, saw the first episode, and it's kind of weird to see him like that like leap from that to him just being tipsy. But he is kind of goofy on the show, so that's good. So that's why somebody recommended this to me on Patreon, because I watched the first episode of IT Crowd. He was hilarious in the first episode. I like actually I like him and Moss. Him and I thought I messed it up again, so I was saying Ross on the thing. I like him and Moss are both the characters, man. I like them both. I still want to see what's gonna happen with like what type of character Jen's gonna be, because sometimes people they'll write like a character kind of like I don't know, clumsy like the lady essentially is just like the one who wags a finger at the guy. I don't know if you guys watch enough shows. That's usually how it is. Like the guys do a bunch of dumb stuff and the chick is just a finger wagger. Like you shouldn't do that because you always need a voice of reason to kind of balance out like the I guess the best word for it is like the idiocy or the foolishness that happens with everything. So I think that voice of reason. And I wonder if she's going to be a voice of a reason or if she's going to be somebody more like Sweet D off Always Sunny in Philadelphia who just kind of adds to the chaos. I'm hoping she just adds to the chaos because that'll make it a much, much, much funnier show. Because the other part is kind of like a, I don't know, a tired role. They kind of do that a lot. So I'm hoping that's the case. But I enjoyed this. I appreciate this being recommended to me. I'm looking forward to watching a lot more IT Crowd with him in it. I heard he's done some other stuff too, so I'm going to start with the IT Crowd and then we'll go from there. I was also told that Moss has been on a lot of talk shows and he's as funny as, I believe, Lee Evans or Lee Mack. I can't remember who he said. I think Lee Mack and someone else, like, they're kind of like on that same level. The guy who's always there, who I say looks like my buddy, he's always in the middle, on the left side. I'll get his name. But yeah, he said like they're about on the same level in regards to like wittiness. All right, guys, that is all for this. I'm hoping you guys are happy, safe, and healthy. And I'll see you guys in the next one. Later.